Well, a very warm welcome on this very wet and cold evening to St. Martin in the Fields. A very special welcome if you're joining us from another part of London or another congregation or indeed from any part of London. And if you're joining us online tonight, we welcome all those who are joining us for this live stream. Neil MacGregor needs very little introduction here in this congregation. But for those who would like to know more about Neil, let me just say he was the director of the National Gallery from 1987 to 2002. He was the director of the British Museum from 2002 to 2015 and is founder director of the Humboldt Forum in Berlin. And many of us have loved his award-winning radio series. The History of the World in 100 Objects is still one of my favorites. And if ever I can't sleep, on goes The History of the World in 100 Objects. Shakespeare's Restless World, Germany, Memories of a Nation, and the incredible Living with the Gods, which I've had the privilege of listening to again in the run-up to this lecture. And As Others See Us, another fascinating broadcast, taking voices from all around the world and getting the comments and views of people from other nations about how they see the United Kingdom. We are delighted to have him with us at St. Martin's and grateful for all he shares. Neil is a person who's attentive to detail, generous in his ability to help us rethink and rediscover our own meaning and our own relationship with the world and one another. He takes the specific, the object, the practical, the picture, the ritual, the symbol, and helps us to see it in relationship to the community, to the nation, indeed, every corner of the world. Neil, we're delighted to have you with us.
Thank you, Richard, for that very generous introduction. And thank you, everybody who's here in person tonight, battling against rain and pestilence. It's very, very good to be here. I'd also like to thank those who are in charge of the technology, which makes all this possible, and makes it possible also for us to be joined by people who cannot be physically in the church. And that's where I want to start, in the church, in this church. One of the more endearing habits of our politicians when asked what they're going to do about a problem is to start with the phrase, well, we are where we are, which is not only a glimpse of the transcendentally self-evident, but usually the prelude to making it quite clear that they're not going to take any responsibility for where we are. But we are in a very special place tonight, and those who made it have a great responsibility and have discharged a great responsibility. And I want to start by looking at some aspects of the church and then to move into the bigger question of how the Christian tradition sits today in the context of other faiths, how the Christian God and the worship of the Christian God can sit beside and work along with those who have other traditions in our city. I want to start with the four letters above the altar. The four letters written in gold, four Hebrew letters in the burst of sun coming through the clouds behind me. They are the Hebrew letters of Yahweh, God's name from the Hebrew scriptures, written, Sam Wells assures me, in impeccable Hebrew script and in proper right-to-left order. God's name in the Hebrew scriptures, equally hallowed in the Christian scriptures. And it's the place to start, because it reminds us not just that this is the house of the long tradition of the God of the Old Testament and the New Testament, but above all, that this is a holy place. And in this house of God, one key question must always be asked. What does it mean to be the people of God? But this is also, as well as being evidently the house of God, it's also a place of political power. In this beautifully decorated church, a church of the dark brown of the pews, the white of the paint, and the gold, there is only one moment of colour, and that is in the royal coat of arms above us. It's a very significant presence because it reminds us that we are part of a political unit. It's here partly because this is, as you will know, the Royal Parish Church, the parish church of St. James's Palace and Buckingham Palace, and indeed the parish church of Whitehall. This is a place where political power comes into contact with the worship of God. It's the coat of arms, as you can see, supported by the lion and the unicorn of England and of Scotland. But it's a very particular coat of arms, because it is the coat of arms of George I. This church, built in the 1720s, properly has the coat of arms of the new monarch, and it's very different. You'll notice, I want you to look for a moment at the bottom right-hand corner. You won't be able to see very much in the way of detail, but you will be able to see, I hope, a white horse. It is the white horse of Hanover. And the four quarters of the shield, as you look at it on the left, England and Scotland, the Kingdom of Great Britain. Next, the fleur-de-lis, the Kingdom of France. Then, bottom left, Kingdom of Ireland with the harp, and then the arms of the Dukes of Brunswick and Lüneburg and the Elector of Hanover. This is a new king, a new coat of arms for a new society, and it reminds us how important it is to think about the relationship between a religion and the political structures of its society. This is a moment when Great Britain decided it was going to change who should be the monarch, who should have the royal coat of arms for the Protestant succession. It's a decision about living with different faiths, different traditions, or rather it's a decision not to live with different traditions. This is going to be a Protestant country, and the German Elector of Hanover will come in order to keep it that. And in that Protestant country, Catholics will have a very complicated position in Great Britain and even more in Ireland. But it is important, I think, to put it at this point of this evening, because it does make the point very clearly that one of the things that holds a society together, one of the most powerful things that holds a society together, is the story which that society tells itself about its relationship to God. How do we, the people of the country, of the state, relate to God? Both these objects, the name of God and the Royal Coat of Arms, are in this wonderful building, which is also a new way of thinking about tradition. In this Protestant country with the Protestant king, it's a Roman Catholic, James Gibbs, who builds this church. And he does something very remarkable. You can see around you the classical Roman elements of the columns of the church that you all know. And that is, of course, the language in which most people in the late 17th century, early 18th century, thought it was appropriate to build a grand public building. But you all know that outside, over the Roman columns on the portico, is a great English steeple. That was an enormous shock in the 1720s. And I think it's an important point again to dwell on, because two traditions are in dialogue in a very unexpected way. The steeple comes from a Gothic tradition of the old medieval English northern tradition. The Roman architecture from a different one. Wren, when he starts rebuilding the churches of London after the fire, works in both traditions, but he keeps them separate. St. Paul's is a totally Roman building. You would hardly know that you were in England at all. When he comes to parish churches, the inside of the churches are very often like this in a classical language. But when he has a steeple, he keeps it separate. He puts it outside, connected, near, but separate. The perfect example is St. James's Piccadilly, built just before this church. The internal arrangement is quite like this one. There is a steeple, but it's separate beside. Gibbs, a few years later, takes an enormous step. He brings the steeple, he puts it on top of the classical church. He brings the steeple into the fabric of the church. He brings two traditions together. And that's a symbol I think I want to hold on to. Two ways of looking at those problems. You can keep them apart, as in James's Piccadilly, church and steeple, side by side, connected but distinct, or you can bring them together and really integrate them and make of it something new. And it's one of the very pleasing paradoxes of that newness that Gibbs, the Catholic architect, coming from Scotland, whose Stuart kings had just been exiled, is the man who builds this Protestant church, which becomes, across the English-speaking world, the model of the Protestant church. And that combination of those two traditions is found right across the English-speaking world, across the British Empire, and across the United States. But there's another reason why this is a good place to start, and that's because of the window behind me. It's a window which, like those four Hebrew letters, Yahweh, attempts to give form and expression to an idea, to an experience, which is essentially beyond words. It's an attempt to render, if not the understanding, then the apprehension of what it means to have God with us. And like the church building, it pulls together different traditions. The artist, Shirazeh Hushyari, was Iranian-born, trained in London. And she's drawn here on the Sufi Muslim traditions of Iran and of many other parts of the Islamic world. Those traditions of thought and of expression to explore what the cross and Jesus' suffering on the cross implies for us now. At the point where, in a normal representation of a crucifixion, you would expect to find the head of Christ, she has placed light. Light in a shape that for many recalls an egg that speaks of transformation and of growth. And from that light, at the center of the cross, at the heart of suffering, comes energy. Markings on the glass radiate out from it to the very edges of the windows. Everywhere, little marks like rays exploding from that center of light. And the presence of this light, the presence of this force, has, as you can see, already begun to make the straight lines of the cross to flex and to bend, as though they can no longer contain the energy that the light brings with it. It's an image which is not an image. It's a representation of something beyond representation, a very Sufi approach to the question. And I think any of us who have spent time looking at it will know that as we look at it, it changes. As we change, we see more in it, it grows. It is, of course, what was meant to be the case for all paintings made for churches, altarpieces, whatever, that regularly looking, we would see them in a constantly different way. And it's no disrespect, I hope, to Richard and the other clergy, say that there are many sermons where it's particularly important to be able to look at something and think about something and explore what it all means to you. Because this window is, I think, about waiting and watching and wondering and remaining still and open to what will reach us or what we can reach as we look at it or through it. It's a good place, I think, to be asking the question I want to ask. The title of the lecture series that Richard has organized this year is, as you know, In What Do We Trust? And Tom Holland talked about learning from history, Rowan Williams about trusting in faith. I'm not a historian of the ancient world, and even less am I a theologian. And I want really merely to ask some questions and to start with the title of the series, In What Do We Trust? Who are the we in that question? Who are the we that are doing the trusting? Is it this congregation? Is it Christians in general? Or is it all of our society? I want to assume that it's all of us. And the royal arms are a constant reminder that we're not just a congregation, but part of a polity, of a state, in which questions of faith have always had a significant part to play. We none of us need reminding that today, religion and living with different religions is as important and explosive a political question as it was in the 1720s. Nor do we need to be reminded that our society today contains many people of different faiths, faiths far further removed from the Christian tradition and from the tradition of this church than was the case in the 1720s. What I want to ask this evening is what that means for those of us who approach God from within the Christian tradition. And that is where I start. I'm a person of uncertain faith and constant questions. But I can ask those questions only in the context, in the tradition of the Christian faith. That's the only language I have in which to explore the question of a relationship to God, either personal or societal. So coming from that position, I want to ask the question, what should be our relationship to the gods of our neighbors in this parish, in this city, in this country, or indeed anywhere in this globalized world? Can we honor their gods as we would want to honor them? Can we learn from their gods something fundamental and important about the nature of divine love, the nature of God, which is not so easy for us to learn in our own tradition? In most other areas of life, as we all know, we've gratefully taken from our neighbors, the neighbors that decades of immigration and globalization have given us, we've taken an enormous amount. In this country, our music, our fashion, our literature, our sport have all been transformed in the last 70 years by living with neighbors who were different from the neighbors of a century before. Most strikingly of all, our food. It's impossible to imagine any British town today now without a Chinese and an Indian restaurant. And it's more than just a joke to say that the national dish is no longer fish and chips, but chicken tikka masala. But it's more than just the fact that going to eat the food of our neighbors, we've incorporated that into our own diet. The way we cook at home has been enlarged and enriched. The different foods have become what we live on. They've expanded our own existing diet. They've become part of what nourishes us. But what about the different understandings of God? Have we been able to welcome them in the same way? Have we been able to draw nourishment from them? All around the world, as you know, conflicts are arising, are continuing between people of different religious traditions, if not actually about religious questions, between groups who define themselves very largely in terms of their relationship to their faith. We all lived and live with the inherited problems of Northern Ireland, the problems which that coat of arms and the 1720 decision did not resolve, and which are still there as reminders of how difficult all societies find this. But we also know that in Myanmar and in Nigeria, in the Philippines and in many parts of Africa, in Sri Lanka and indeed in France, tensions, violent tensions are there and explode. How the communities relate to the society, how they relate to each other, is a critical question. What do we do about it? Well, the answer is, of course, as everybody would say and does say, more or less everybody, tolerance. The freedom to practice religions, the freedom to practice religions, and the obligation to show respect for other traditions. Most states now have that written into their constitution. Most politicians would agree with that, certainly in Europe. The Prince of Wales has made it clear he would like to see his future royal title as defender of faiths rather than of faith, acknowledging that in the country of which the monarch is the head, there are people of many faiths which need to be defended and respected. And the latest papal encyclical, Fratelli Tutti, All Brothers, addresses this question directly and talks about how important it is to live peacefully and respectfully with other faiths. But is that enough? Does that still leave us separated one from another, even if the separation is courteous? Does it still leave it like the steeple at St. James's Piccadilly, beside but not part of? Nothing has been incorporated in this tolerant Christianity that we have all come to know, or very little. Very little has been made part of the fabric of the thought of Christian tradition. We look at the others, we respect them, we work with them, we love them, but they remain not part of the fabric of the thought on the whole. It's a position summed up memorably by Rabbi Lionel Blue. Those of you who are old enough to remember his appearances on the Today program will know who I'm referring to. And one of his great standing jokes was about tolerance between religions, and told the story of a rabbi in conversation with a vicar, disagreements, but nonetheless agreeing that they would disagree and separating on friendly terms, with the rabbi saying, "Well, you will of course worship God in your way, and I shall worship him in his." That, I think, is broadly where we are. But can we go further? Are there in those other traditions, the traditions in which our fellow citizens find spiritual strength and ethical nourishment, truths about God that we need to pursue and which we can add to our Christian traditions' understandings? Can those of us learn from the Christian tradition, from those other faiths, and be fed by them? It's a question that the church, like the Jewish tradition before it, has traditionally found extremely difficult. And I want to go back to the name of God over the altar, the Yahweh, the God of the Hebrew scriptures, the God who appears to Moses, and the God who says to Moses, in the words of the commandment that we all learnt as children, "For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God." It's a difficult word, a jealous God. It's not what we would normally, I think, quickly leap to as an attribute of the divine. In Hebrew, I'm told, it's the word that would normally be used for a husband concerned about the infidelity of a wife whom he loves, the difficulty, the reluctance to see her transfer her allegiance, her affection to anybody else. It's an expression of love and the desire to be in the closest possible relationship. That's certainly how Sam Wells approached the word when I asked him how he would interpret the jealous God. But that is difficult because further on in that passage from Exodus, you remember this is the God who is going to punish children to the third and fourth generation if any engagement with other gods takes place. How in this tradition, which is still part of our tradition, are the followers of other gods to be treated? One example, but one example that I find particularly disturbing and which I think we need to address. It is those who follow the other god widely followed in the area of the ancient Near East, of the Levant, of the Holy Land, Baal. Followers of Baal and followers of Yahweh in conflict. Elijah, you may remember, summons the priests of Baal, and they have, if you like, a competition to see which god will prevail in making fire. The pyres are built, the wood is wet to make it very difficult, and then both sets appeal to their god, and Elijah's wood takes fire, and it is shown that Yahweh is supreme. It's a very straightforward narrative. But then, once this has happened, Elijah, the prophet of God, the voice of Yahweh to his people, orders that the priests of Baal should be murdered, all of them. That's in 1 Kings chapter 18. A little further on, 2 Kings chapter 10, Jehu, the anointed king over Israel, the anointed king over Israel, anointed of the Lord, tricks the worshippers of Baal to come to a celebration. And then he orders all of them, not just the priests, but all the worshippers, to be murdered. In the Bible that I was given as a child, which helpfully breaks up the chapters and has headings to tell us what's going on, it writes very simply, Jehu exterminates Baal worshippers. In neither case, Elijah or Jehu, is there any apparent indication that Yahweh disapproved or reprimanded them? I'm not a scholar in this area at all, and I may be wrong, but it seems to me there's a great difference here between a God who works with somebody like David, who sins, who breaks the commandments, who strays from his love to God, and who is punished, and then with whom God works, and then whom God calls to great things. That doesn't appear to be the case here. The murder of the priests and then of the followers of Baal is something that appears to be done, that is done, in the name of Yahweh. I don't want to make too much of this, but I find this very problematic and very uncomfortable. Like many passages in the Old Testament, it suggests a God with which many of us find difficulty in identifying. And yet, the Old Testament is read regularly. It is meant to teach us something profound about the nature of God and his relationship to his people. And I would like to be, I would like to have more understanding of how this view of Yahweh and the prophets of Baal works. It seems that nothing is to be learnt from the other gods, nothing to be tolerated. And it's a view that was carried over, as you know, by many Christians, those involved in early missionary work in the Americas and Africa, often approached indigenous religions and indigenous religious traditions as though they were the priests of Baal. Moving from that, I want to ask, is Jesus a jealous God? It's, I think, an important question, and I'm not theologian enough to answer. We don't, of course, know all his teaching, but he doesn't appear to call for the destruction of those who practice other faiths, those, for example, who follow the Roman gods. I think he suggests that the Sumerian traditions of worship are not so close to those of God as they could be, but he seems to avoid, quite carefully to avoid, saying very much about those who follow the gods of Rome. But one aspect of the relationship between Jesus and other faiths is set out in the New Testament, and it's set out very clearly, and it's set out even before he is in a position to say anything at all. Right at the beginning of the New Testament, in the second chapter of Matthew, is Jesus' first encounter with other faiths, the wise men. And I want to dwell on that moment of the scripture, of the gospel, for a bit. You all know the text as well as I do. The wise men from the east came to worship the King of the Jews. Matthew has added this part to the narrative of Jesus' life found in Mark, just as Luke has added the shepherds. And as the shepherds in Luke come to salute and to hail and to worship the great shepherd, Christ, so the wise men come to the wise teacher, Jesus. They come seeking wisdom, and they acknowledge in their gifts the stature of Jesus, which Matthew is keen to point out, the Jews do not recognize. The wise men, who are generally thought to be Persian Zoroastrians, that means they are monotheists, they believe in a single God with a very highly developed ethical tradition. They come to salute and to acknowledge another, and to honor, above all, they come to honor another tradition, a different address to the divine. And that first encounter of other faiths and the Christian faith is marked on the part of the other faiths by generosity, the gifts they bring, which show that this child is a king, is a priest, and is human, and will die. They honor him in that way, and then they go home. I think it's important to point out that this, particularly in the ancient world, is a perfectly normal thing for people to do. Even today, if you come as an important representative to visit a king or a sovereign, you bring gifts. State visits are about the exchange of gifts, and then you leave. There's no suggestion at all that when they went home, they became Christian. No suggestion at all that their faith was materially disrupted. Simply that they had acknowledged and wanted to encounter a different way of thinking about the divine, a way which they could see deserved respect. It's very different from the account given in the poem by T.S. Eliot that many of you will know, The Journey of the Magi, written in 1927, the one that begins memorably, "A cold coming we had of it, just the worst time of the year." There, Eliot presents the Magi as coming, seeing the child, and not recognizing another wisdom and honoring it, but being undermined in the confidence in their own tradition. We returned to our places, the poem ends, these kingdoms, but no longer at ease here in the old dispensation, with an alien people clutching their gods. It's an extraordinary thing that Eliot has done. He turns what is an encounter of respect into a moment where the Magi have lost confidence in what they were, and they see their own people no longer as the people they left, but an alien people clutching their gods. It's 1927, and I think most people, most of us would agree that that vision is one of a Christian triumphalist relationship with other faiths. A relationship not hinted at in the gospel, but which is nonetheless very clearly articulated there. The Zoroastrians are still active, are still very present in our world, have gone on developing their traditions. They're now mostly the Parsi communities in Mumbai and other Parsi communities around the world, producing families and benevolences like Tata. No suggestion in that world of being no longer at ease in the old dispensation or people clutching at idols. Eliot wants to see supremacy, and he's not alone. If I ask you to imagine in your head an image of the wise men, and this is where, as an art historian, I bitterly regret that we don't have slides, because I would, of course, run you through an image, a series of them from the National Gallery. But I think most of you will find that in your head, the picture of the wise men that comes to you is not of the wise men dressed as Persians, but as kings. It's the adoration of the kings. And this is an extraordinary transformation. Somewhere between 500 and 1,000, the wise men became, for most people in Western Europe, the kings. The Magi became the three kings of Orient. How did it happen? Well, this is, first of all, a triumph of biblical scholarship. It is, of course, as you know, a given that the Old Testament and the New Testament have to be read together, they explain each other, and much of the Old Testament is prophecy, which will demonstrate what is happening in the New and what it means. And biblical scholars fairly quickly light on a passage from Psalm 72. The kings of Tarshish and the Isles shall bring presents. The kings of Sheba and Seba shall offer gifts. Yea, all kings shall fall down before him. All nations shall serve him. It didn't take very long for people to start suggesting that the wise men were, in fact, the kings prophesied in Psalm 72. And by certainly after about 500, there are references to them in manuscript scholarship, biblical scholarship, of them as kings, and they're given names, Balthazar, Melchior, Caspar. All that's fine, but I don't think many of us would know this if it hadn't moved from the text to the image. And somewhere around 900, between 900 and 1,000, across Western Europe, the Magi stop being shown as Persians, as wise men in Persian costume, and start being shown as kings. The oldest example that we know of this happens in England. The Benedictine of St. Ethelwald made in Winchester just before the year 1000. And then you get it across the whole of Western Europe. And it's generally agreed that what is happening is that the monarchies of Western Europe, the kings of Western Europe, the new structures of power, want to appropriate the power and the authority of the church by aligning the kings and the Christ child, their place in the narrative. The search for wisdom from the West has become, the search of wisdom from the East has become absorbed into the quest for power in the West. And images are very, very powerful. It's no disrespect to any scholars in writing to point out what we all know, that it's the popular image that changes the way people imagine and people think. And from the year 1000 on, in illuminated manuscripts, in stained glass, in sculpture, and then in paintings, overwhelmingly, it's the kings. You know them. It becomes the language of the church. Western Europe regards the 6th of January, the feast of the Epiphany, as the feast of the kings, La Fête des Rois in France, Dreikönigstag in Germany. It is the moment at which the king's royal power and Christly presence combine. And on the 6th of January at the Chapel Royal in St. James's, to this day, the monarch presents, as a monarch, gold, frankincense, and myrrh to the Christ child. But something else has happened here. Once you move into kings, you move really into power. When kings meet, who is supreme? It's perfectly clear up above, kings claim authority over others. That royal coat of arms has the coat of arms of France. Kings of England claiming to be kings of France. They hadn't been kings of France for 300 years at this point. Nobody expected them to go become kings of France again, but they claim it, and you put it in the shield, and it stays there, astonishingly. The kings of Great Britain claiming to be kings of France until the French abolished the monarchy in 1793, killed the king, and at that point it's rather less appealing, of course, to want to be the king of France. And only then did the French arms drop from the British royal coat of arms. It's what happens when kings meet. And one has to be supreme. And the images in the National Gallery show you not two monarchs meeting, they show you a scene of royal tribute, of submission. They show you kings paying homage, as kings of the earth pay homage. And as they represent the different parts of the world, they're shown magnificently robed and dressed in a kind of royal durbar, very like the imperial durbars of the Raj, with the local chiefs, recognized as chiefs, magnificently robed and bejeweled, submit. This, I would argue, is not a trivial transformation, and it corresponded for a long time to the general view of the church in its approach to other faiths. The manifestation to the Gentiles came to mean the submission of the Gentiles. Can we escape from this imperial imagery, this imperial habit of thought? Can we go back to something much more like what, had the Christ child been able to speak, might have been the dialogue of the wise men in the house in Bethlehem? What is now the position of the church in relation to other faiths? I think it's fair to say that until very recently, it was exactly as seen in those images. The only salvation, the only truth was held in the church. And those who were not part of the church, non-Christians, were unlikely to attain salvation and were certainly not to be regarded as possible sources of understanding. That has now moved a great deal. And the general view, I think, insofar as possible to talk about a general view of Christian churches, is that there's a recognition that other faiths have a sincere quest for understanding with God, of closer union with God, and that no limits can be set to the saving powers of Jesus, and that it is therefore possible to consider these other faiths without thinking them necessarily doomed or totally wrong in their direction of attempt to understand. It's for Francis in Fratelli Tutti, Pope Francis, a big further step was taken. He calls not just for respectful cooperation, but he reminds everybody that St. Francis visited the Sultan in Egypt during the Crusades, and at that point specifically advised his colleagues not to try to convert them. Francis quotes the words that they were not to engage in arguments or disputes, but to be subject to every human creature for God's sake. Francis, the Pope says, did not wage a war of words aimed at imposing doctrines. He simply spread the love of God. It's a big step forward. There's no longer an assumption that you need to try to convert, with all that that says about the people you're trying to convert, and suggests a profound respect. And I want to return to the question of going further. Can we learn? It's a good place to ask, because we're in front of a window that unsettles and explodes our systems and structures. And it's a good time to ask what we can learn, because COVID has shown how many people want to know more about their relationship and our society's relationship with God. The online response has made that very clear. And above all, it's a good time because one of our neighbors has given us such a powerful demonstration of the riches of another tradition, deriving from a different understanding of the divine in our lives and of our relationship with it and with each other. It's an episode of how we can literally be nourished by contact with another tradition. And it is the work of the Sikhs in the Punjabi restaurant just up the road who came to cooperate with Richard in feeding those who would normally have been fed at the connection after the connection had closed. Richard had gone for a takeaway. The owner of the restaurant had heard that he was trying to keep food available for those who would normally have found it at the connection. And he explained that as a Sikh, he had decided that he and his colleagues, because the restaurant could no longer function, would keep preparing meals for the Sikh charity that prepares, that feeds homeless people. And they'd been preparing more than 1,000 meals a week to provide to those in need. And he wanted to help Richard, and so regularly produced every week food for up to for 60 or 70 people that could be shared to all. He's still doing that. We're now in a position to pay something for it. But that was a gift, and a gift that came out of a deep Sikh tradition of service to others, and the tradition beside every Sikh temple of having a langar, a room where food is given to anybody, of any faith, any tradition, anybody. That is the service of the others, which is the service of God. It's a very powerful and moving example of what we can learn and be inspired by, I think, from other traditions. But I would like to go one further, because there's another aspect of the Sikh tradition which seems to me remarkable. It's their insistence that nobody, not even they, or especially not they, have a monopoly on the understanding of God. That there are many different understandings of God, and all of them are fragmentary, all of them are only in part, and nobody has a monopoly. Now that's perhaps a difficult thing for the Christian tradition to accept. A tradition where our scriptures are thought to contain the full revelation, and where everything necessary for salvation has been given to us. Can we make that step? Can we say that there is no monopoly on understanding of God? And can we draw from those traditions? I want to look at a few other traditions from India that I think raise similar questions, and then finish. From the Hindu tradition, above all, it's, as has often been pointed out, Hinduism is a series of complex practices and traditions that would never have been put together as one religion had the British not tried to find a system and to understand it. It's far too wide, far too diffuse to be carried in the language that we have. And this is always one of the problems about talking about other faiths. Not only do we talk in ignorance, or I do, but we don't have the words in our tradition to address the concepts with which they are living and working. But imperfectly, though we can address them, I think we can see in the Hindu tradition some aspects of the divine which are important to consider and which are different from ours, but appear to be addressing questions with which we still struggle. The first, perhaps the most obvious one, would be the relation to the natural world and the ability to see in all the natural world the divine presence, not just in the river, the Ganges, and in other rivers, but in the whole of living creation. The divine is held to be present and must be respected and nurtured. That is something with which we, in our tradition, still struggle. The Old Testament, God speaking to Noah, is absolutely clear when you come out of the ark that the animals are there to be killed, that everything is there to be used. And we all have been trying to move, many have been trying to move to a different position, but the texts don't make it easy. And the Hindu pattern, tradition, and belief is a very different one and appears to me to be, in many ways, much nearer the point where we feel we should be, what our understanding now of our relationship to the world and to God in the world might be, perhaps should be. The second point from the Hindu tradition would be, of course, the question of sex and gender in divinity. It's not just that the Hindu tradition has gods of both sexes. It's also that the sexuality of the human is articulated and honored as something that has in it inherent elements of the divine and is revered and represented as such. It's inevitably, as you know, an area where the Christian tradition has really struggled. It's really struggled to manage this relationship between the sexes. And although a great deal of discussion about whether the Trinity can sustain the notion of a relational idea of God, a God where love and relations are central and they are one of the expressions of the divine, it's hard to get to the same kind of position as the Hindus with a Trinity where two of the persons of the Trinity don't have a physical body, and where the language of our scriptures is so predominantly male in the talking of God. The fact that Jesus talks about our Father, the fact that the language is, as we know, predominantly male. Many people were disappointed in the Pope's encyclical that he talks it about fratelli tutti, all brothers. The tradition thinks in terms of male and doesn't easily embrace the questions of physical sex. In the Hindu tradition, there are many representations of the god Shiva as both male and female. Not hermaphrodite, fully both. This is an enormous statement about the nature of the divine, fully embracing, fully reflected in male and female. It's one with which we struggle. And finally, there's a capacity, even though the Hindu tradition has the idea of one creative spirit, there's a capacity within it to embrace new thoughts about the divine to the extent that the Buddha is seen as one of the avatars, one of the manifestations of the god Vishnu. It's a structure that allows other insights to be embraced and honored very fully within the tradition. Those are the questions I want to ask. Can we learn from these traditions, the Sikh, the Hindu? And finally, perhaps rather unexpectedly, the ancient Romans. The ancient Romans had, as you know, many gods. And they saw the gods as how a society organized itself, articulated itself. Worshipping the gods was to affirm the community. And when they conquered new territories, one of the ways they incorporated the new territory was to honor the god of the conquered. The gods of Egypt, the gods of the Middle East, were brought back to Rome. Temples were built in Rome. The Romans worshipped the new gods along with their old ones, honored them. They had become different because they were new citizens in the empire. And this must, I think, have a great deal to say in explaining why that empire could accommodate so many different faiths over so many centuries and survive and flourish. It's an awareness that it is the god is the story of the people. The relationship with the god is the community. And to honor the god will allow you to honor the community. It will allow the conquered citizens to become full citizens of Rome in a way that is fully respected. To go back to Baal, the Romans have the same question. What do you do with the worshippers of Baal? They build a temple to Baal in Rome. They bring the stone, which is held to represent Baal, to Rome, honor it, and build a temple for it. Could not be more different from the approach given to us in the Book of Kings. We're living in a society that has also incorporated a great many new citizens with new traditions, new faiths. And how are we going to handle all that? The Enlightenment century that gave us this church also gave us the belief that you could separate individual faith from the organization of society and a community. We know that that's only possible up to a point. One of the greatest identifiers of communities is their religion. Can we now change that? And this is where I want to finish. It's a lot to ask of the Church of England, a church that finds it difficult even within its own house to give full equality in the house of God to different sexualities. Can it learn something from other traditions? Can it address the questions of how we should think differently about the gods of our neighbors, about the trust that our neighbors put in them, and what we might be able to trust in them and in our neighbors' relationship with them? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Neil, for doing what you promised you'd do, raising many interesting questions for all of us. I'd like to ask you perhaps some more personal things about your own journey, because you are someone who has had an opportunity that many of us in the church maybe have not had, to have researched every part of the world. And I mean, in living with the gods, you really do travel to many different places. Have you ever been like those magi? Have you ever been introduced to another faith or another faith experience where you felt like kneeling down and thinking, wow, this is astonishing. This is enlarging my idea of what God is.
Absolutely. It happened many times. One of the extraordinary things about working at the British Museum is that you're working with objects which embody the deepest and most important ideas in other people's cultures and traditions. And how you handle those objects, in every sense handle, is of course a very delicate and difficult question. But the conversation that most impressed me in that sense was with an Australian Aboriginal artist who came to the British Museum, where there are a number of Australian Aboriginal artifacts, and began to talk about the understanding of a particular Aboriginal community, and I think it's the case for many, of the idea that within the locality, which everybody knows, where the community has always lived, every single part of the landscape is divine. Every part of it, even the wind, the water, the rocks, and every part of it is connected to a story about the relationship of the divine. Again, this is where the words become impossible. To say gods, spirits, has a set of other connotations which take us away, but the nearest I can get is the divine. How the entire landscape is suffused as something divine, which you are inhabiting at the moment, and where you can discern the presence of your ancestors and of those still to come. And a wonderful, an amazing way of thinking about the landscape you inhabit, which I'd never encountered before, and certainly never heard anybody talk about before. It was a very moving, it was a profound, it was an experience that changed my thinking.
Sacred space, you've talked about this sacred space, you've talked about the window and the coat of arms and the name of Yahweh. In your travels and in your experience, what is it that creates a sacred space? What is it that makes a space sacred? And can that sacred space be a part of different faiths as well for you when you go? Can you feel or experience the sacred space of another faith?
I think most of us have had the experience of going into a place where you are aware that for a long time people have use that space in an attempt to engage with the divine and engage with questions beyond their own particular existence and beyond their own local circumstances. And it's something about that space, I think, that can be transmitted. The space that most again surprised me and moved me is much nearer home than the Aboriginal one. It's in Ireland, just north of Dublin, a building called New Grange. It's a Stone Age building built by the local farming community over several generations, 3,500 years ago, aligned precisely so that at the winter solstice, on the day when the sun starts returning to the north, the sun shines along a passage right into the depth of the hill. It's built in a hill, and we think that's where the bones of the dead were kept, at least for some time. And the light of life returns, and returns every year at exactly that moment. And the space is still intact. The alignment is still absolutely operative. And an overwhelming sense of people knowing they were dependent on the world of the sun and the moon, knowing their dependence on the natural world around them, finding a way to honor that and to mark the fact that life keeps returning, and that individuals die, but the community will continue. And I think those are the spaces, and I'm sure we've all had experiences of similar ones, where you're aware that what this is about is not the individual life, but how the community will continue, and how the community will still be connected to the divine.
Do you think ever, though, that a religious concept needs to be redeemed? I, as you know, lived for 15 years in the Solomon Islands, and there were a lot of ancestral sites there where headhunting had taken place, and there were still the skulls that many people went back to worship the skulls. But there was a feeling, not just for me, but if I went to those places, of a real darkness and a real joy that the end of that blood feuding had come to an end, and that actually Christianity had brought light and peace, and it had brought a sense of salvation from the fear of the gods, as it were. Have you experienced this at all?
Not in those terms, but I know this is very much is a very common pattern particularly in the Pacific, where there was a very strong sense that Christianity was bringing release from the fear of the gods. But I think all traditions have the dark places from which redemption is required. I think my response to it is that, sadly, I don't think we have found that. Our dark place for the whole of European civilization is, of course, the Holocaust. And I don't think we have found a place or a way of articulating the way in which Christianity has redeemed us from that as a society. I think we're still finding a way of articulating that. How do we say it? How do we make it into either give it expression in a place or in a ritual? The places that exist to address it are, I think, almost exclusively secular. And for obvious reasons, it would be very great complexities in a Christian attempt or a Christian assertion of redeeming the community from that act against the Jewish population. So I'm afraid, I think there, we still have a huge unresolved problem.
You say in your book, we tell stories in order to live. What are the stories that you tell from our Christian tradition that you think are still life-giving for our society at this time?
Yes, it is one of the, that phrase is a quotation from Joan Didion, we tell ourselves stories in order to live. And I wanted to use it because one of the very interesting things about early anthropology, the study of deep history, as it's called, I mean small societies long ago, is a growing belief by anthropologists that the communities that survive are the communities that had a story that held them together, to get them through the winter, to get them through whatever. This is one of the reasons why almost all societies that we know, I think virtually every society we know, has some kind of religious structure, some kind of religious narrative. The suggestion is that only societies that had that actually survived at all. So those who didn't have it, that's why we don't know of them. It's, I think, a very convincing argument that and it goes back to what Rowan Williams was talking about, hope. Hope is not just the vague idea that somehow everything will get better or that you wish it were different. It is that somehow, that because of a power of good, a power of love, some power, over time, the community will go on and will return to health. I think the nearest we came to a national narrative of that was probably the opening of the Olympics in London, where there was a narrative constructed of community and of service and of humor and of openness, which did look very like a narrative which could hold us all together, and in which there was a very strong place for the Christianization of our society, what Tom Holland was about, talking about the aspects of our society which have been shaped by the Christian teaching to foster that kind of community, that kind of service. I think that's the nearest we've come to it that I can think of. And it's disturbing how quickly it appears to have faltered as a story that can hold us all together.
You know, Rowan mentioned the you know, we love the NHS is part of that narrative that was seen in the Olympic Games as well.
And precisely that. And there I think one can see exactly what Tom Holland is talking about, the language in which the foundation of the NHS took place was a language entirely shaped by Christian teaching and Christian thinking, even by the people engaged in it who were not themselves actively Christian. The language, the framework of thinking was entirely a Christian one.
In your book, you say that one expects religion, without religion, that there will be a loss of morality, or without religion, there will be more criminality. But you say the biggest loss without religion is community. In what way is that true?
Well, I think it's perfectly clear that people can be just as moral with no religious pattern of observance as those who have. I mean, we all know that. The question is much more, I think, what holds a group together. And the power of religion to create a community is something that you can see everywhere in the world at the moment, particularly in moments of stress. It's the shared narrative that reminds you who you are part of, what is the community that will carry you through. I think that's something that, again, Western Europe lost at the moment of the Enlightenment, when we tried to insist that religion is a private matter, not how a society thinks.
What would be, you say, to learn from other faiths, what would be the treasure that you've brought back to your Christian faith that has expanded you, that has made you question your own Christian faith?
Well, as I said at the beginning, I'm a person of flickering faith and uncertain faith. So it wouldn't be a question of what I'm bringing back to my Christian faith. It's what insights into the nature of the divine that I think are convincing. And first of all, it would be, I think, and most importantly, the fact that there is no monopoly of understanding, that the starting point, with the only starting point which I could be comfortable with, is that no tradition has the whole story. A kind of humility in approaching the question and approaching other traditions, which has certainly historically not been a defining characteristic of the Christian tradition. In the other area, it would be very much, I think, the question of the sacred nature of the whole of creation, which I think is underdeveloped in the Christian tradition. It may be there waiting to be developed, and this is maybe what the task is, to find in the scriptures that we have, in the teaching and the traditions that we have, to find these elements that seem to us, or to me at least, to correspond with my understanding of the divine. So it would be the divinity of every aspect of the world, I think, is one of the key things to recover, or to add in that sense.
You gave an example of the worship of many gods, polytheism with Baal. And even today, when you talk about gods, when we put it in the title, there's still a certain element of fear in that when people start talking the gods. Why are people frightened of the idea of more than one god?
Well, it goes deep. I mean, it goes back to, I mean, clearly in the Christian tradition, it goes back to what we were talking about the jealous God and the belief that there is only one true church, only one true message. And the pagans, the Gentiles, were always derided as having gods in the plural. That's often and misunderstanding. Often there's one creator spirit manifested in different ways. But the fear runs very deep, and you only need to read something like Achebe's book, The Center Cannot Hold, to see the damage that does when the missionaries arrive in Nigeria at the end of the 19th century, and the whole social fabric collapses because the missionaries will not see what the gods represent to the community and how it holds them together. The fear is, I think, largely the fear of conviction, an absence of doubt, an absolute certainty that the Christian tradition is in possession of the only truth. Because let that go, and to recognize that this may be one among many truths, or only part of a great truth, a greater truth, would mean changing a great deal of the traditional teaching of the church. It would mean abandoning a great deal of the traditional teaching of the church, and it would mean going back to those scriptures and really saying, which bits of this do we think are telling us something about the nature of God?
So you talk about your own flickering faith, but I heard you praying here in the church last Sunday. Why do you come back yourself to the Christian tradition, and why do you keep praying within the framework of that Christian tradition?
As I said, it's the only language I have. It's the only tradition I have. I find it very sustaining. I find it nourishing. I find it addresses an enormous number of my questions. And I find in it the address to the questions, the answer to the questions, to many of the questions that I need to ask. And I find that very nourishing, and I want to keep being part of that community of trust, that community of engagement with that understanding of the divine, those teachings of Jesus. What I find difficult is to think that the other traditions in other faiths are not of validity in terms of adding to our understanding.
Do you think prayer can become a way of coming to a greater unity, of learning more from other traditions? I was doing a meditation on Saturday, and I met a Muslim who was a Sufi, and he suddenly started talking. It was a really wonderful conversation. But it strikes me that some of the people who've really been able to travel and to move, people like Bede Griffiths and Thomas Merton, were people who actually found a unity in a deeper contemplative life.
I don't know enough about that to answer, but I think it brings me back to what I feel about this window, that kind of prayer is, it seems to me, in large measure, an openness to apprehending something that you cannot understand. It's an openness to acknowledge that this is beyond words, beyond the individual. Our tradition is very much based on words and argument and understanding. That kind of prayer is about recognizing the limits of understanding and the openness to an apprehension beyond words. And that is, I think, a universal.
It's an epiphany, isn't it? That's the meaning of epiphany, an opening up to an understanding beyond ourselves.
Exactly, exactly.
Questions from our audience here, or if you've got any questions online. I know Catherine Juice is collecting some questions that have come through the Facebook Live. So if anyone has got a question, we've got two microphones, and the stewards have asked if you can come down the center, keep your 2 meters social distance, ask your question, and return by the side aisles. Anyone would like to ask a question? Let's have some hands. Yes, please. Yes.
You were speaking about how we should view the faiths as fragments of interpreting the divine. By taking that position, is that not in itself a position of supremacy where you're saying your interpretation of the divine, which is that faiths are fragments, could that not also lead to a monopoly? And would that also imply that you could see the bigger picture? Because, as in a building, if you found bits of a building, you would most of the time know they were from the same building by seeing the building itself, and that being the divine. Sorry, that's a long question.
No, thank you. It's a good question. It's certainly not what I meant, and I don't think it's implied by what I was saying. To start from the position that the divine is beyond any human understanding, and that we have been given access to some understanding, and for us, very nourishing access to that understanding, is not, I think, to suggest that in any way that there's a monopoly, which is quite the reverse. In fact, precisely what I was trying to say, precisely the opposite, that there are other understandings which will enable people to live very rich lives in community, equally rich lives and nourishing lives in community, and which will give insights into the divine which are much harder to grasp in ours, and which will also not be part of the whole story. So I think it's much more to say not knowing what the building is, not knowing how the picture ends, but knowing that we're only seeing part of it.
Thank you.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Thank you very much. And there's a question from Wendy. If you can speak out rather than look behind, otherwise we'll miss this.
Yes.
Thank you very much, Neil. As ever, fascinating. I just want to, what you've talked about is how we can look at other faiths, find things that are different, and nurture those, use those to nurture our own faith. Karen Armstrong looked at five major faiths and took a different way, which was to see what they had in common. Do you think that's an equally valid way to look at what we hold in common?
I do. I think it's a very valid way. I mean, partly because Karen Armstrong had taken that way, I wanted to try to come at it from a different angle.
Yeah.
I mean, clearly that's a very, very important way. And it certainly makes any question of persecution, it explains why that's not a sustainable position, which is still a very important question, as we know. And it's also, I think, explains why it's understandable now that the compulsion to convert has also receded in most faiths. And I think that's what comes out of, in many ways, out of Karen's book. I wanted to address much more the question from the Christian tradition and indeed the Church of England. This is a church for the country. That's what that coat of arms reminds us of, not just for those in the church. And I think the question I wanted to ask was, how far can the Christian church in general, but the Church of England in particular, how far can it think about enriching, expanding its understanding of the divine from other faiths, not just respecting them, but actually saying, here is something that adds to our understanding. Is that actually possible? That has certainly been my private experience, that engagement, contact, looking at other faiths, even at a superficial level, has added to my understanding. But it's not generally the way the church addresses it. And I think that's a big question. Is that what the church thinks, or does it believe that its understanding is already complete?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, please, Martin.
Neil, you said you were speaking really from somebody who come from the Christian tradition. And I wondered what your perspective would have for somebody that, say, is outside a faith tradition. Because I wonder how is it possible to sort of embrace aspects of different religions and then find a way to ally yourself maybe with one above the others? Or should you not? A lot of people seemingly find it difficult to come to a religious faith if they might think, oh, well, there's bits from all of them. It keeps might tend to keep you a bit separate. It's easier if you've come from that background, I suggest, but increasingly more of our society have not come from that background. And I just wonder, does a religion need something distinctive in order to draw people in?
Thank you. These are really questions for a theologian. I think most people in our society we know do not now have a strong practice in a religious tradition. They may have inherited elements of it, but the majority of our fellow citizens don't practice within a religious tradition. Your point is, of course, clear that it's difficult if one were coming completely from outside. Where would you choose? Where would you start? I certainly am not in that position. I've grown up in a tradition that I find extremely fulfilling. And extremely challenging, as well as, I hope, in some measure, redeeming. The question, I think, is what other, and I think that's true of every faith, the people, if you've grown up in it, or if you've moved into a practice in it, you find in it nourishment and sustenance. It's simply a question, I think, of whether one can look beyond the structures that have traditionally been extremely divided. We know we've lived in a world where, particularly in Western Europe, we structured the world in terms of different religions, and a right one, ours, and the others. That habit of thought has receded, but it's still the residue of that, the legacy of that is still present. And I would see this very much as working within a tradition, but with the tradition of humility, that tradition is not the only one that has crucially important things to say.
Thank you. Any questions from, no. Any more questions? Yes, over here.
Thanks for your speech. It was very informative. I don't really understand everything about the substance of what's going on here, but what I would ask is the egg a representative of a chicken, or is it the representative of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God? It just seems obscure to me that it would be an egg rather than something more abstract, should I say, and that was my own question.
Thank you.
It's a question that, of course, only the artist could answer. I hope I didn't call it an egg. I think I called it an egg-shaped light, which is what I meant to say, that it's light, intense light, in the shape of an egg. I don't know what the artist intended, but I think for most people, that shape suggests new life. It suggests becoming. And I certainly find that a very credible meaning to attach to that power of light coming from the cross and transforming everything around it. The point, I think, of this kind of art is precisely that it is to be open, that it is for everybody to look and see whether it does speak to them, and if it does speak to them, what it says. That is very much in the tradition, as Richard was talking about, of Sufi prayer, of opening yourself to what appears to be what's suggested, to what reaches you. But it's clearly, in some sense, a meditation on the cross, on what the cross means, what happens to the cross, what happens to the world because of the cross. And that is right at the heart, of course, of the Christian tradition, what that means, which is certainly something of fundamental importance to me, but also to everybody here, and to many of other traditions, what that means and how one can engage with that.
I know many of you will have read this already, but it really is an incredible read. I read it a second time in preparation for this lecture and the radio program as well. But it ends with a wonderful image from the Schutzmantel Maria of 1480, which is the Virgin Mary spreading out a cloak, and underneath her cloak there are 10 figures, which suggests the whole of society. Neil, just the last question, what would be your vision of what a church should be?
I thought that's what you were paid for.
That's why we get people like you to come in.
That image is a particularly powerful one, just very briefly. It's a wooden statue of the Virgin Mary, about that high. And she is much bigger than the other figures. And under her cloak, she has gathered this representative group of people, young, old, male, female, different classes. And it is the whole society. What is powerful about it is not just that the Virgin Mary is meant to represent the church, of course, but that she has this group and she is actually walking forwards. That is perhaps the most important thing of all. It's about how you take a whole community forwards into a future that nobody knows, with the confidence of trust of the protection. I don't think we can now do that through a physical image, a representational image. It's not the way our society now works. We don't have an image for the church the way medieval Europe could use the image of Mary. What I think we do need is a language for the church that embraces all of our society, which is why the question I've been asking seems to me so important. The society that is now our society, an established church, what does the church of the nation, if that is to have any meaning, how does it present itself as a structure, a way of thinking, a way of being a community in which everybody in our community can find their place? That's the challenge. It'll need to be done in words, but it can be done in words, because words can carry these things. And I don't think it can now be done by an image.
Neil, it's been a pleasure for all of us to be with you. Thank you for sharing with such openness, with such truthfulness, and such grace. Thank you for modeling the openness.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, Richard.
Thank you, all those who have joined us online. Just to remind you that our next and final lecture in this autumn lecture series is on November the 2nd. It's Trusting in Scripture. We've got Paul and Wooder, Chancellor of St. Paul's Cathedral, and a brilliant New Testament scholar. She'll be here, and Sam will be chairing that evening. So do come again, or watch us online on November the 2nd at 7 o'clock. Obviously, to put on a lecture series, it does cost money, so if you can text the word lecture to 785, you will donate £5. That's lecture to the number 785, you will donate £5, or you can, if you're in church today, you can put £5 in the basket as you go, or any other donation you'd like to give. Thank you for braving this cold night. I hope you've enjoyed being with us. It's a great pleasure to see you here in this sacred place. Do come again. We're open every Wednesday and every Sunday, and we're also, as you know, open online, and hopefully open, as Neil would say, in our hearts and spirits too. Thank you.